So in this first part of the class, of the course, I address the genealogy of the dictatorship of no alternatives. Its presentation in the world today. And the circumstance in which the progressives find themselves. And I do so by focusing on two contexts. First, the United States, and then Europe, European social democracy. Today, the topic is the United States. But before addressing the American circumstance, I want to begin with some general remarks about method, to make explicit the way of thinking underlying this discussion that I propose of the American situation. And I will do so, as in the other parts of this intervention today, in a very compressed form. All the ideas that I am about to mention are ideas to which I will return in the last part of the course in much greater detail. So these ideas about method concern, on the one hand, the object of transformative practice, the chief object, which is the institutional structure of society and how to think about it. And second, the problem of agency, the relation between the programmatic alternative and the social and political alliances or constituencies that can support it. So in my argument about the American alternative, I assume, as I do throughout this course, that the chief target of transformative ambition is the institutional framework of society, and in particular, the economic and the political institutions. So today, the institutional form of the market economy and the institutional form of democracy. As I suggested in the first class last week, the major theoretical tradition influencing the progressives or the left, and especially the Marxist tradition, prompts us to think about structure and structural alternatives in a way that, to my mind, is fundamentally mistaken. So that tradition assumes that there is, in history, a limited menu of alternative institutional regimes, such as feudalism, capitalism, and socialism. That each of them is an indivisible system, which must be either managed or replaced, and that the succession of these systems in history is governed by laws of historical change. My assumption is to the contrary, that all of these ideas are false, unreliable guides. And yet, and this is the core of our intellectual problem, we cannot dispense with the idea of structure and of structural alternatives if we are to imagine the overthrow of the dictatorship of no alternatives. So for the moment, I want to focus on only one aspect of this debate, the debate concerning how to think about structure and structural change. And that's the idea that the institutional frameworks are indivisible systems. That idea I suggested last week implies a binary view of politics. Either we have the reformist management of a system, or we have the revolutionary substitution of one system for another. What that binary view excludes is what in fact seems to be the primary mode of structural change in history. The wholesale transformation or substitution of a system seems to be a limiting case, and for the most part just a historical fantasy. Structural change, when it takes place, is almost always fragmentary and occurs in steps, in pieces, in moments. And nevertheless, if it persists in a certain direction, its outcome can be radical. So under the influence of the dominant intellectual traditions in social and political thought, we are accustomed to associate gradual, piecemeal, stepwise change with the absence of radical alternatives. And to associate radical alternatives with the wholesale substitution of a system. But the view that I'm taking for granted in my arguments this week about the United States and next week about Europe reject this assumption and proceed on a different assumption, which is that the association of structural change with fragmentary or piecemeal transformation is in fact not only possible, but almost always necessary in transformation as it actually takes place in history. Now let me address the second idea about method underlying these arguments about the United States and about Europe. Here, the topic is agency. How to think about the relation between the institutional alternatives and the political and social agents for the development of these alternatives. And without defending or detailing the view, I simply want to outline it in its most general form to make the subsequent argument about the United States and later about Europe intelligible. So this view can be stated in the form of three theses. Let's call the first thesis the correspondence thesis. According to the correspondence thesis, any conception of an alternative can always be stated in two registers. Each is just the reverse side or the complement or the corollary of the other. In one register, as an institutional conception, not a blueprint, but a sequence of institutional changes in a particular direction. And the most important attributes of such an argument are that it mark a direction and that it identify in a particular circumstance the initial steps by which to begin to move in that direction. The other register is the conception of agency, of the agent, of the formation of the constituency of this alternative. And according to this view that I'm labeling the correspondence thesis, We should think of these two sets of ideas as being, in a sense, two parts of the same idea. So every conception of an alternative can always be stated in this double form, as a view of the alternatives and as a view of the agents. Every powerful institutional alternative developed over time implies and helps create its own constituency. So the constituency is not just antecedent to the alternative. The constituency is developed through the making of the alternative. Now, the other two theses are going to help make that first idea, the idea of correspondence, more persuasive. The second thesis about agency is the thesis of duality. The thesis of duality states that every group or class interest can be defined and defended in two sets of ways. In one set of way that is socially exclusive and institutionally conservative, and in another set of ways that is socially inclusive or solidaristic and institutionally transformative. And the best way to explain this idea is to exemplify it. So the core historical constituency of the progressive or left-leaning parties in the modern West is organized labor headquartered in the capital-intensive sectors of the economy, especially in industry. And that's what we call mass production, the production of standardized goods and services with relatively rigid machines and production processes, very hierarchical and specialized work roles, and semi-skilled labor. And as we will discuss later in the course, this practice of production is in crisis throughout the world, in all of the advanced economies, and is in the process of being replaced by another knowledge-intensive, radically innovative or experimental form of production, from which the vast majority of the labor force remains excluded. Now, faced with this crisis in the practice of production, the decline of so-called Fordist mass production industry, the leaders of the left or of the labor movement can take two main positions. On the one hand, they can try to contain or slow down this process of decline of mass production. They can fight a rearguard action to prevent subcontracting or outsourcing of jobs, to preserve the traditional productive units for as long as they can. And under that view of the interests that they're defending, they accept the present conception of the interests of their constituency, and they build into the niche. And under that view, their chief enemies are actually the neighboring groups in the social and economic space. So the temporary or subcontracted workers at home or especially abroad, who are the rivals or the substitutes of the stable labor force, or the small business class. That's what I'm calling the institutionally conservative and socially exclusive way of defining and defending the interest. But there is always a second way of defining and defending the group or class interest that is institutionally transformative and socially solidaristic. So in this example that I just gave of the decline of mass production, that view would say this decline of mass production is irreversible. What we have to do is to influence the process of economic transformation so that the next practice of production, the one that replaces traditional industrial mass production, develops in the form that is as socially inclusive as possible and does not result in radical economic insecurity for the majority of the labor force. Now that then requires the development of alternative institutional arrangements for the economy, alternative ways of relating the state to firms or firms to one another. That's the institutionally transformative part. And it requires a different way of thinking about the antagonists and the allies. So on that view, the groups that in the first view were defined as the threat have to be redefined as the potential allies. In the development of an inclusive, a socially inclusive form of the economic alternatives. Now, of course, the problem is that the first set of views, the views that are institutionally conservative and socially exclusive, are always most tangible, whereas the others represent a hypothesis, a possibility of the future. And then there's what the economists would call a principal-agent problem. The political or labor leaders don't live in the future, they live now. And the way of thinking that will be most natural to them in responding to the proposal of an alternative would be to say, you're asking me to fight for an alternative. I risk undermining my relation to my existing constituency before another constituency has developed, and I risk being left with nothing. So they don't live in historical time, they live in biographical time, and are therefore resistant to the risks that the transformative strategy requires. And so we always have the problem in a transformative practice of how we can redress this imbalance between the immediate and tangible attractions of the first set of ways of defining and defending a group interest and the risks, the audacity required by the alternative set of ways. Now we come to the third idea about agency, and let me call it the asymmetry thesis. And the asymmetry thesis has to do with the way that we should think about the relation between social or class alliances and political alliances. And the suggestion is the following. On this view, a class alliance or a social alliance always presupposes a political alliance or a movement with a structural program that will consolidate it or develop it over time. But the inverse is not true, or at least not true in the same way. A political alliance or a political movement does not presuppose an antecedent class alliance or group alliance. It has the development of such an alliance as a project, as part of its work. So, of course, the work is only feasible if it succeeds in taking the initial steps with the materials that are at hand. There has to be some sequence that leads from the existing conventional understanding of the interests to some other understanding. And that's a large part of the work of transformative practice in the world. Leading people to reinterpret their interests and ultimately their identities in the light of structural alternatives. Well, there's a summary of the conception of agency that I'm presupposing in these arguments, and which you can see is a complement to the idea about structure with which I began. Now, it's actually very, very important to be clear about these things. They may seem to be abstractions or theoretical preliminaries, but they're absolutely decisive for the way in which we approach all problems of transformation. So now, before I turn then to the United States in the light of these preliminaries, let me stop and ask whether you'd like to discuss some aspect of these ideas. They're all controversial, but I simply want to make explicit my working assumptions, because either we think this way or we think some other way. And the assumptions that we make about these matters will shape the whole way in which we approach the problem of structural alternatives. Yes? Speak a little more loudly, please. Yes.
How exactly would it be on a basis of what kind of area they work in? Would it be a geographical basis? Or how would you envision these kind of different frameworks? How would they be spread apart? Because would be some that are more favorable to some businesses than others that they might want to flock to. And how would you make sure that these different frameworks are well populated with different firms?
Let me see if I can understand. So are you saying that there's a problem in that workers in different parts of the economy, if you take my example, would approach this problem a different way? Or? Well, the assumption is that there are problems that are pervasive in the economy. Take two groups that at first seem to be very, very far apart in the economy and society, which are the labor force, the organized, stable labor force in the capital-intensive sectors of the economy. the historical constituency of the left parties. That's one group. The other group is the small business class, the petty bourgeoisie. You couldn't imagine two groups that are further apart from the standpoint of the traditional taxonomy of the progressives. In Europe, in the 20th century, the left defined the petty bourgeoisie as its main enemy. This was a calamity, because the petty bourgeoisie then became the core constituency of the right-wing political movements in 20th century European history. And today in the world, you could say that there are more petty bourgeois, or aspirants to a petty bourgeois condition, far more than there are industrial proletarians, traditional agents of the left. So just numerically, it's a conflict that has been lost before it even begins. So what happens in these economies, including all the most advanced economies of the world, is that most people work in small retrograde enterprises in the economic rear guard. That's where most people are. They're either in the small business class or working as employees of the small business class in the small business world. And then you have the labor force in the capital and intensive sectors of industry caught in this process of relentless decline and disintegration of traditional mass production industry. Meanwhile, a new technological and progressive vanguard is emerging, but the vast majority of people are excluded from it. So the question is how you begin to think of these problems as related. So the problem of the small business section is how it can cease to be retrograde and gain access to the advanced practice of production. And the problem of the labor force caught in the declining mass production industry is how it can pass to an alternative practice of production that has another future. These problems are connected. They're obviously connected, because they're connected through the fundamental project of establishing the economic alternative, the advanced practice of production, in a socially inclusive form. And that would have implications, to the extent that it developed, for both these worlds that I've just described. But there's a huge gap between here and there. That's the problem. And faced with the intimidating effect of that gap, the initial tendency is to retreat to what I call the institutionally conservative and socially exclusive way of defining and defending the group interests. And it has no future, but it has a present. And because we live in biographical time, it's as if the future didn't matter or mattered less. So that's just in a few ways, in a few words, a way of summarizing the whole predicament of the progressives in the contemporary situation. And the question is how we get out of that. Yes?
Following up on the previous question.
Yes.
When you mentioned earlier that organized labor and the system of mass production crisis.
Yes. Or and what's the alternative? Or?
Or recent developments in and so on.
Well, it's the same thing, isn't it? It's a history. It's just two moments of the same process. So the core constituency of the left parties in the West and in much of the world, even outside the West, is organized labor in mass production industry. That's the core. Then other things were added to that core. The whole form of union representation and organization presupposes mass production. So it presupposes the aggregation of large numbers of workers with stable employment in large productive units, such as factories, under the aegis of large corporations. And actually, that way of organizing labor in history is relatively recent. It only became predominant from the middle of the 19th century onward. And its heyday goes from the middle of the 19th century to the middle of the 20th century. So that way of organizing labor was preceded in the Western economies by several centuries in which work was organized on the basis of decentralized contractual arrangements. The putting out system. The so-called capitalist gives the raw material and the machine to workers who, for example, work at home with their families and friends. Now you could say that that's what's happening again in the world. That labor is once again being organized now on a global scale on the basis of decentralized contractual arrangements. So a small group of people sits in California and designs things, and then they contract everything else out, and they're fabless. They have no factories of their own. They don't need to. So this is one of the aspects of the economic transformation. So the first instinct of the progressives faced with that situation is to somehow slow it down or to stop it, to stop that transformation. But maybe it can't be stopped or it shouldn't be stopped. And then the task becomes to master the alternative rather than to prevent it from happening. That's another way of stating the problem. Yes?
I have a question about your statement, which I try to write down, but it seemed that you said that we cannot dispense with this historical change model. We're to imagine the overthrow of the dictatorship of the alternative. It seems to me that your thesis of asymmetry,
yes,
would effectively try to undo that model, or dispenses this with a certain model, because it seems to establish the primacy of political inspiration over hardcore economic relationships.
Yes and no. So what it says is that the way that different groups or classes or segments of the labor force understand their interests and identities is always relative to some existing established form of economic organization, as mass production that we were just discussing. And as the institutional arrangements change, the way of organizing the economy, the understanding of the interests and identities also changes. So if you reified, if you took for granted only the existing way of understanding interests, you could never get from here to there in history. That's the dilemma that has to be solved in a transformative practice in some way. And that's why I say that the transformative project carried out through political action and programmatic inspiration has as one of its tasks the creation of its own constituency over time. But the constituency can't be created from nothing, ex nihilo. It has to be created with the materials that exist. the existing arrangements, the way in which people now understand their interests and identities. So you have to get from here to there by a series of intermediate steps. That's always the problem that has to be solved in transformative practice. And if it couldn't be solved, the world would never have changed.
I mean, I think that the asymmetry principle though seems to establish this kind of importance for political vision, because it doesn't go both ways, right? So people who are kind of caught in their own economic reality, it would seem you're saying, cannot produce new political visions. But people with political vision can organize new political reality.
Yes, except that there's a danger of interpreting the asymmetry idea in a simplified and radical way, which would make it seem that it's just a kind of malleable clay. You have political inspiration, and then suddenly people's understanding of their interests and identities. It's not like that, of course, because the material with which you're working, we are the material. Our understanding of our interests and identities is recalcitrant. So you need to have a foothold, a place to begin. And that's the importance of what I call the duality thesis, that there's always a place to begin in the multiplicity of ways of defining and defending a group interest. There's not just one way. Now here comes, and I hadn't intended to bring this up, but it seems necessary in response to your provocation, a sharp contrast between this way of thinking and the way of thinking that is implicit in Marxist theory, the controlling influence on the left, the controlling intellectual influence. So in Marxist thinking, the interests of every class, the classes are the main agents in Marxist theory, the main agents in history. The interests of every class are objective. And related to the place that they occupied in the foreordained succession of the modes of production, the institutional systems. So people can be temporarily mistaken about their class interests, especially if class conflict and the political struggles associated with it have not been radicalized. But on this view, the wider the scope and the greater the intensity of class conflict manifest in politics, the more transparent the objective content of the class interest becomes. So fighting reveals the truth about the objective content of the class interest. And if you are deluded about the class interest, the price you pay is political defeat. History teaches you otherwise. That's this view. Now, the view that I am presupposing in this conception of agency summarized in the three theses is exactly the opposite of that view. It's not just different, it's the inverse of it. Because what it's saying is that the impression of objectivity of group interests or class interests is a derivative illusion from the situation of stagnation. When there are no alternatives on the horizon and no conflicts about the alternatives. So in this example of mass production, if there are no alternatives, and it seems it's either mass production or nothing, mass production or radical economic insecurity and unemployment, then the only thing that's left to do is to fight to defend the present system. But if there are alternatives, then on this view, the view summarized by the three theses, the greater the scope of conflict and the greater the intensity of conflict, the more the question, what are my interests as a member of a certain class or group, becomes inseparable from the question, what are the accessible alternatives? And who would I become under each of those alternatives? And what would my interests and identity then be? So it's not just different. It's the inverse. It's turning the Marxist view upside down. I'm saying it matters which of these views is true. It matters decisively for the way in which we approach transformative practice. So this is a very large, it's a very large question, but one that we can't escape. Now there's a huge amount of confusion in the world, because to summarize the intellectual situation of the left or the progressives, they on the whole have ceased to believe in the heroic assumptions of classical Marxist theory. So if you ask them, do you really believe that there's this closed menu of institutional regimes in history, that each of them is indivisible, that there are historical laws governing their succession and so forth, the answer is no. They can't bring themselves to believe in all of that. So William James said, people believe in everything they can. So they can't. They might want to believe, but they can't. They can't believe in that. But they don't have clear alternative beliefs. So if I were to present to them these theses about agency, they would be taken aback. And they have to think, wait a minute, we'll have to think about that. Because on the surface, it seems to be, for example, a radical voluntarism. They continue to use the vocabulary as if they believed in the system in which they've ceased to believe. So for example, the concept of capitalism, which makes sense only in its theoretical context. If it's not just the label for the market economy defined as institutionally indeterminate, it's the evocation of a system which has its laws, which you either just manage or replace, the binary view of politics. So they're in the same situation that people in the contemporary world are, for example, with respect to religion. Do they believe in it or don't they believe in it? It's like they want to believe in it. And they're in this situation of half belief. Now, I think that this kind of intellectual confusion is not a problem for conservatives, because the world doesn't need ideas to reproduce itself. But it is a problem for people who are out to change the world, because then you need to have ideas. And you need to have clear ideas. And then this kind of intellectual confusion is a disaster. But that's the situation of the contemporary progressives. It's not so much that they subscribe to ideas that are false. It's more that it's not clear what ideas they subscribe to, because they half believe in these traditional ideas. And instead of replacing them, their tendency is to water them down, to dilute them. So, they subscribe to these beliefs in some loosened form. That's not good enough as an intellectual basis for transformative practice. But that's our situation on this view. Now, we come to the United States. So, especially since I devoted the first part of the class to these important questions of method. I'm left with a very limited amount of time, and I want to present a comprehensive view of the American situation as an example, but I can only do that telegraphically. But I hope not so telegraphically that the different parts of the argument become enigmatic. So I want you to interrupt me, but I'm going to try in the course of the remaining hour to get through every part so you can see the whole of the view that I want to suggest and discuss with you. And I'm going to proceed in four steps. The first step, very briefly, is an evocation of the circumstance now of the progressives and of the progressive alternatives in the United States. Then the second step is to go back in American history and in the history of American progressivism to form a view of the making of this present circumstance in the hope that the historical experience will provide clues to the development of an alternative. Then the third step of the argument is to return to the circumstance now in greater detail and reconsider it in the light of the historical experience. And the fourth step is then to begin to outline the main features of an alternative direction in the American situation. So that's the agenda that I have in mind. So I hope that as I proceed in this argument, much that it's puzzling in the early steps of the exposition will become clearer, be made clearer by the later steps. But it's absolutely vital for you to challenge me and intervene and question as we go along. So first, the situation now. Beginning or accelerating in the 1970s, the United States underwent a series of momentous inflections of changes. Greater inequality in all dimensions. Lessening of political engagement and thinning down of social capital, of association of people with one another. And nothing that the progressives did then or have done since then has contained or reversed these inflections. There is the temptation to define these changes that have taken place in the United States as the result of objective, relentless, and irreversible forces, such as technological change. But in fact, I want to argue, these changes can be understood only as being, at least in part, the result of ideas and actions, the creation of politics, and not just as a kind of natural phenomenon. In this circumstance, on the whole, the progressives have not had a project responsive to the needs, interests, and aspirations of the broad working class majority of the country, especially the white working class. Their predominant tendency has been to soften or humanize the project of their conservative adversaries, to put a human face on the alternative project. On the other hand, the conservative adversaries of the progressives, in the circumstance of this vacuum that I've just described, the vacuum of a progressive project, developed a formula of power, which has been successful for half a century in the United States. And the formula of power could be summarized in the following way. It is the combination of material concessions to the interests of the moneyed classes, such as lower taxes and less regulation, with non-material concessions to the moral interests of the moneyless classes, the moral agenda on issues like abortion. That has been the formula of power in the United States, made possible by the absence of a progressive alternative. Now, that's all I want to say for the moment about the present circumstance, because I want to return later in the third step of my argument in much greater detail to this. After the historical inquiry. So can I proceed then to the second step? So the historical inquiry. I want to begin with an idea of the crucial element in the formation of the United States, of American democracy, from the time of independence to the Civil War. So there was a, on the top, by the national government, a project of mobilization of resources, physical, financial, and human resources for the building of the country. This was the Hamiltonian project. An elite, a loose elite of politicians, entrepreneurs, hangers-on, adventurers, bureaucrats, organized a project of nation building on a large scale, including the physical structure of the country, to open it up and to create instruments such as the management of the public debt for this resource mobilization from on top. But this element interacted with a second element in the development of the United States. And that was radical institutional innovation in particular sectors of the economy, especially agriculture and finance, both of them crucial. In an economy that had not yet industrialized. So this came up last week. In agriculture, the Americans rejected the English path of agrarian concentration They distributed the land on the agricultural frontier. And they organized an alliance between the government, the central federal government, and the local governments, and the family farmers, to develop the technological and commercial and cultural infrastructure of family-scale agriculture. And they supported what, in today's vocabulary, we would call cooperative competition among the family farmers. The family farmers were independent proprietors, but they also cooperated among themselves to achieve economies of scale. And the result was the most efficient system of family-scale agriculture that had ever existed in the world up to then, and that was completely different from what prevailed in Britain. In finance, there was a conflict over the interests of the financial plutocracy and its main instrument, the National Bank, and it culminated in the dissolution of the National Bank in the presidency of Andrew Jackson, the prohibition of interstate banking, and the subsequent development of the most decentralized system of credit that had ever existed in the world. So these initiatives in agriculture and in finance were not the regulation of the agricultural or the financial markets, they were the creation of new kinds of financial and agricultural markets. To some extent, democratizing economic opportunity in a decisive way in these two sectors of the economy. At the same time, of course, under the shadow of the tremendous incubus of African slavery. When Tocqueville visited the United States in the 1830s, only one white man in five worked for someone else. It's an astonishing fact about the economy. So you have an economy, a society, in which basically everyone who is free works for himself. With its characteristics deepened by these democratizing initiatives that I've just described. And this double movement, mobilization from on top and democratization from below, in an economy of largely independent, self-employed economic agents, then found an ally in the voice of the American prophets, like Emerson and Whitman and Lincoln. The idea of radical self-construction of the individual. The ordinary person becomes big or bigger and rises to a higher level. So this is, I want to claim, the fundamental dynamic to which the United States owes its greatness, its power. This is what made the country. And then this dynamic progressively weakened in subsequent American history under the impact of economic and technological and demographic change. But how are we to understand the progressive weakening of the dynamic? It seems that there were two crucial elements in the weakening. One element is the limitation of democracy. To develop this democratized market economy, it would be necessary to keep reinventing it through new institutional experiments that would respond to the changing circumstances. And that requires a democracy that can master the structure of society and of the economy. But the American democracy, like all the democracies that exist in the modern world, was restrained in all sorts of ways. It provided for a very limited level of popular engagement in political life, initially with multiple qualifications on the suffrage that were only very slowly overcome and then replaced by the influence of money on politics. And it committed itself to a series of constitutional arrangements, Madison's constitutional plan, that deliberately slowed politics down through the scheme of checks and balances. It associated by institutional design rather than by institutional necessity the liberal principle of fragmentation of power with the conservative principle of the slowing down of politics. The greater the transformative ambition of a political project, the more severe the constitutional obstacles that would have to overcome. It was intended to be that way. The second influence on the weakening of this dynamic, of the double movement from on top and from below, was intellectual. It was the absence of an idea or the failure of the development of an idea that a free society in its economy and in its politics has no natural institutional form. Its institutional arrangements are always contestable. So the predominant ideas in economic, political, and legal thinking reified a particular version of the free society. And failed to develop the institutional vocabulary necessary to reconcile economic democracy or decentralization with the aggregation of resources on a large scale. And as this dynamic weakened, the dual movement of national mobilization from above and institutional democratization from below, what advances is the marriage of corporate power with high finance. So now let me introduce a second step in the argument, in the historical picture. The two major traditions of progressive reform in the United States from the early 19th century up to today, there are two main traditions. One tradition that goes from Jefferson to Brandeis and beyond is the tradition of defending small business against big business. And the second tradition, which is the tradition of the late 19th and early 20th century progressives and of the two Roosevelts, is the tradition of accepting the occupancy of the commanding heights of the economy by big business, but then saying big business must come under strong regulation by the central government. Now, these two traditions of progressive reform had something in common. And what they had in common is that they did not dispute the institutional form of the market economy. they did not seek to continue doing what the Americans in the early 19th century had done in finance and in agriculture, which is to reinvent the institutional content of the market economy rather than just to regulate it, or rather than just to compensate for its inequalities by retrospective redistribution through progressive taxation and social spending. So the consequence is that these two traditions of progressive reform fail to supply a way of continuing in new form the dynamic that had actually developed the country that I described at the first step of the argument. Now let's come to a third moment in this historical argument, which is the second Roosevelt's New Deal, which Americans look back today, to which Americans look back today as the last great moment of institutional innovation in the United States. And I want then to summarize a view of it that is unsentimental, but also does justice to its achievements. So you could say it went through four moments. The first moment, right at the beginning, from Roosevelt's coming to power to the middle of his second term, was a moment of institutional experimentation in the organization of the economy and of the relation of the state to the market. Now, Roosevelt was very radically experimental in his attitude. Nevertheless, the content of the institutional experiments was very limited. And for the most part, the early institutional experiments of the New Deal took the form of what political science today would describe as corporatism. So it was concerted action, agreement between industry and labor to manage and limit competition and achieve economic stability. Economic stabilization rather than economic transformation was the keynote. Now, there's something very strange about this, because the attitude, Roosevelt's attitude, and the attitude of many of the people around him was quite radically democratic and experimentalist. But the content of their institutional innovations is very limited. And why? So here's a fact that we're going to have to come back to many times. They were at the mercy of the ideas around them. So the way the progressives often think is there's no problem of ideas, because when you need them, you get them. But it's not like that. The stock of institutional ideas in the world at any given moment is very inelastic. The progressives often conceal this fact from themselves. So the way they talk, it's as if they were hiding, for tactical reasons, a plan, which they in fact don't have. And what happens is, if you don't talk about it and develop it collectively, you don't have it. And that's their common situation. Then came a second moment in the New Deal in which the focus of innovation narrowed dramatically to creating antidotes to economic insecurity. And the signal manifestation of this was the Social Security program. a universal program for everyone, not just for a relatively insular group of poorer people. And institutional innovation in a more sustained way continued mainly only in one particular sector, which was the organization of the housing market, with the creation of the governmental sponsored enterprises and a secondary mortgage market. Then comes a third moment in the New Deal, which is the war economy. That was actually the moment of most radical institutional innovation, in which the economy was reorganized on completely different principles under the pressure of military necessity. A free-floating coordination between business and government, and massive expropriation of private income. But the significance of these institutional experiments was quarantined because they were treated as relative only to the circumstance of war and not relevant to a peacetime economy. And everything that Roosevelt had achieved in these first two or three moments of the New Deal were at a cost, for example, of the failure to enforce the labor laws and the civil rights laws in the South. Then comes the fourth moment of the New Deal. Presaged before the war and made manifest after the war, which is the popularization of consumption, the organization of a market in mass consumption goods, which is the most lasting subsequent legacy of the New Deal. The democratization of the economy on the demand side, not on the supply side. And already during the war, Roosevelt was asked, what book would he most like to see in the hands of every Soviet child? And he answered, the Sears Roebuck catalog. So this was the reality of the New Deal in these transformations, starting with this impulse to institutional transformation and then narrowing down. So there's a picture of some elements of the historical background. So would you like to comment or argue about this? Because I would then go on to the third step, which is the circumstance today. Yes? In the first half of the 19th century, yes. Sure. It's limited. It was a limited view of what you could call a petty bourgeois economy, an economy of small-scale, independent economic agents on the basis of the exclusion of large parts of the population, as you just said, and on the basis of a relatively primitive agricultural and service economy. Incompatible with large-scale aggregation. So to live this dynamic would have to be reinvented. It couldn't be preserved in its archaic form to include the excluded, to be compatible with technological dynamism, to serve as a platform for the large-scale aggregation of resources, it would have to take another form. And that would require, on one side, institutional imagination, and on the other side, democracy. There'd have to be a fight in the country about the alternative forms. And I argued in this historical narrative that both the intellectual and the political conditions for that reinvention were deficient. But of course, if you accept a view like the one that I just outlined, that would already be a big step, because nothing would prevent the Americans today from reexamining their situation in the light of a view of their history like this one. They would say, these two major traditions of progressive reform are inadequate for the reasons that I suggested, but we don't start from nowhere. Our own history provides clues to what we should do next. The country was formed by this interaction between mobilization from above and democratization below. And those institutional innovations were associated with a prophetic vision of the greatness of ordinary people. And all of that can be made to live again in a new form. But then the narrow focus on the demand side of the economy and on mass consumption is not enough. So that's already a beginning. Rooted in the American circumstance. So what I'm trying to do, really, by this American example is to say that the problem of progressive alternatives arises in distinct form in each country of the world, in each society. And to be made to live, it has to be represented in a different idiom, steeped in the historical experience of that society. But these national experiences and experiments speak to one another across the world. So this is an American story that I've just told, but the American story is pertinent to all the other national stories in the world. It's like a chain of analogies in the world, rather than a set of watertight compartments. That's the kind of argument that I'm making. But then it can be informed and inspired by a reinterpretation of the national history, which, if you look at it closely, then already contains in itself clues or starting points for an alternative. Now, every single part of this narrative that I just gave is, of course, a polemical. So now, for example, the tendency of the American progressives is to idolize the New Deal and to have a sentimental view of the New Deal. And this is an obstacle, because it prevents them from seeing both what the New Deal achieved and how it failed, or in what sense it failed, so that they can examine their task today in the light of this historical experience without illusion. And there are all these resources in the history of the country that could be appropriated if one understood things without the blinkers. So I just want to insist on this claim here that these two obstacles, the deficit of democracy and the deficit of institutional imagination working together are formidable impediments to the creation of alternatives. So throughout this period, the major political and legal thinkers in the United States held to the belief that a free society basically has a single natural and necessary institutional form. So there's paradox in American society. One of the most salient traits of American culture is a vast experimentalist impulse. The idea that all practical problems can be solved by tinkering undertaken by ordinary people. So it's the central idea of democracy, faith in the constructive genius of ordinary men and women. But the bias in the political culture has been to exempt the institutions from the scope of this experimentalist impulse. So experiment about everything except the institutions. And there has been a line of American thinkers, from Jefferson to John Dewey, who tried to persuade their fellow citizens to lift this exemption that they accorded to the institutions from the experimentalist impulse. For example, Thomas Jefferson argued that the Constitution of the United States should be replaced every two generations so that the dead would not rule the living. Now, what idea could be more offensive to the beliefs that the Americans now hold about their republic? So it's not as if the opposition to the institutional experimentalism, as if the defense of the institutional experimentalism did not have bases within American history and American thought itself. It's that this demand from Jefferson to Dewey has been the minority position. And what has prevailed in the high political, legal, and economic culture has been the idea that the free order has a predetermined institutional content. So shall we go on to the third step? So now back to the situation of the progressives today. And to make my argument clear, I want to present it in an overtly controversial form, intransigent. So I start again with the proposition that the progressives today in the United States, as in most of the world, have no program for the development of a structural alternative in the economy and in politics. And in particular, they have no program that deals with three major structural problems in the economy. The first problem is the relation of the vanguard, that is to say, the advanced part of the economy, the advanced part of production, to the rest. The advanced part of production is now knowledge-intensive, radically innovative production, from which the vast majority of the labor force is excluded. So there's a hierarchical segmentation of the economy between vanguards and rearguards, which becomes then the machine for the creation of inequality and exclusion. The second problem is the relation of labor to capital. So labor in the United States, as in most of the world, is becoming more and more precarious, organized in the form of decentralized contractual arrangements, rather than in the form of a stable labor force. Because of this change in the practice or paradigm of production. And how is this new economic reality to be mastered in law? So that these precarious workers are protected, represented, and organized. The third structural problem is the relation of finance to the real economy. The production system largely finances itself on the basis of the retained and reinvested earnings of private firms. And all of that liquid capital has an oblique or episodic relation to the productive agenda of society. And the financial volatility then becomes destructive in periodic financial crisis. So later in the course, we're going to discuss how structural problems like these can be addressed. But for the moment, I'm simply making the claim that on the whole, the progressives have no project for these structural problems. Now, when I say the progressives don't have a project, it's not just the progressives in politics. It's the progressives anywhere. So on the whole, there is no structural project to deal with these problems, for example, in the academy. If it existed somewhere else, it would eventually resonate in political life. More generally, there is no progressive project for production, for the supply side of the economy, only for consumption, for the demand side of the economy. Continuing the bias of the last moment of the New Deal. And what then occupies on this view the space left vacant by the absence of a structural alternative? So, first, a series of deals with or defenses of the interests of minorities, and the poor as one more minority, as we discussed last week, the politics of the Rainbow Coalition, so-called. Second, at the level of discourse, of political rhetoric, the homage paid to the principle of progressive taxation. So there's no structural program, but there is a defense of the principles of progressivity in taxation. The problem on the argument that we began last week is that compensatory redistribution through progressive taxation and redistributive social spending has only an accessory effect. In comparison to the institutional arrangements that influence the primary distribution of economic advantage, of economic and educational opportunity. So it's as if the genuflection to progressive taxation were a kind of pietistic substitute for the transformative alternative, which would have a structural form. Now, the third thing that occupies the vacuum left by the absence of a structural alternative is, as it were, the subcontracting of the national strategy of economic growth, in particular to the central bank, to the Federal Reserve, the policy of easy money. So to the extent that the United States has a strategy of economic growth, the strategy of economic growth is articulated and implemented not by the national government, but by the central bank. That's one component of the strategy of economic growth. The second component is the democratization of credit. So consider the following problem, which was crucial to an understanding of the financial and economic crisis of 2007 to 2009. How were the Americans able to reconcile the maintenance of a market in mass consumption goods with the radically regressive redistribution of income and wealth that took place in the United States in the closing decades of the 20th century? In principle, mass consumption requires the popularization of demand power, of purchasing power. Part of the answer is the democratization of credit. So it's as if there were a fake credit democracy instead of a property-owning democracy, made possible in part by the overvaluation of the housing stock as collateral. And then the third component in this strategy of economic growth has to do with the structural imbalances in the world economy, and in particular, in the period before the crisis of 2008, the relation of the American economy to the Chinese economy. So China would have to deepen its internal market and have a strategy of growth based on internal demand and not just on foreign demand. But that would require massive redistribution within China among regions, sectors, and classes. And that redistribution would create political conflict, threatening the despotic regime in that country. So then the export of demand, the capital and trade surpluses, become a way of evading the task of structural change within China. Now, the complementary situation happens in the United States. To produce more goods and services that the rest of the world wants, the United States would have to establish the advanced practice of production in a more socially inclusive form. But that would require institutional innovation as well as distributive conflict. So the trade and capital deficits of the United States vis-a-vis China play a similar functional role of allowing the Americans for in a certain historical period to evade the task of structural change within the country, to create the basis for a credit and debt-fueled strategy of economic growth. So that's a picture of the situation. Now, then come these two aggravating factors in the predicament of the progressives. They're what in the vocabulary of American politics are called the wedge issues. The relation of race to class and the contest of moral agendas. So in race to class, the orthodoxy, the progressive orthodoxy in the United States separates the redress of racial injustice from the redress of class injustice and treats it as a prior threshold through policies like affirmative action, which helped establish a black professional bourgeoisie in the United States, but did very little or nothing for the black underclass. And offended the interests and sensibilities of the white working class in the United States. And then the moral agenda, in which in a conflict between the secular and the religious, or the modernist and the traditional, the progressives took the position of the secular against the religious and of the modernist against the traditional, and sought to enforce it by federal power and law. And once again, dividing the potential working class majority of the country. Now, I don't believe myself that any of those positions on those wedge issues were either necessary or beneficial for the country. But these are obviously very, very large debates. I'm simply trying to evoke a picture of the total situation. Because it's in this context that I've just described that becomes possible to understand how the conservatives could organize that formula of power and statecraft that associated material concessions to the interests of the moneyed classes with non-material concessions to the interests of the moneyless classes. Nothing about this stuff is natural. This is a creation. This is a construction of politics, of achievements, of failures, of insights, of illusions. And that's how we get to this circumstance that I've just described. Now, there's one more step, which are the alternatives, but I've said a lot here. So, yes?
I haven't read from you or heard from you yet about sort of the influence of sublimation, of the pacification of working people through mass media and mass consumerism. And what instead I hear is sort of that, well, particularly around these wedge issues, that they didn't work because they offended the sensibilities of the white working class. But the sensibilities of the white working class are in large part conditioned by this mass consumerism, by corporate power. So I guess I just wonder.
And what's the programmatic implication? So for example, a major theme in the mass culture is the theme of empowerment. In fantasy. So the experience of the ordinary person is an experience of belittlement, of humiliation. But the theme in the mass culture is power, adventure, but privatized in this private sublime in the form of escape. But that's a huge potential, because then it's in reserve there in that form of escape. So there's the resentment of toward the state. The state has done nothing for the working class majority, especially the white working class majority. Let it at least not offend our beliefs. And then there's this flight into the fantasies of empowerment, the private sublimities. Required by the absence of any practical expression. So, of course, in this vacuum, then, there's a huge potential for political adventurism to exploit this situation of resentment without providing a real structural alternative. It seems to me you could tell a similar story about every society in the world today. It would just take a different form. That's what I meant by this idea of the chain of analogies. So there are all these contradictions. Power is made of contradictions. And that's what we work with. That's how we get from here to there. That's the kind of argument that I'm making. So is it required by the situation that the progressives be so bereft of ideas about alternatives and of initiatives about alternatives? Why? They weren't before at earlier moments in American history. So I think it would help just to go on to the fourth step and of the argument that I intended, to see what would count as the essential elements of an alternative, of the kind of alternative that is missing. And with respect to each of these elements, I want to distinguish what seems to be more accessible in the present circumstance. So the first element is an economic project, a political economy. Focused on the supply side of the economy, on production, not simply on the demand side and on consumption. And directly addressing each of the three structural issues that I enumerated. First, the relation of the vanguard to the rest of the economy. How can the economic vanguardism that exists in the United States be developed in a more socially inclusive form, so that the advanced practices of production, rather than being quarantined within insular parts of the economy, are widely disseminated? Well, that would require governmental activism, not to suppress the market, but to create a different kinds of markets, as the Americans did in the first half of the 19th century. The economic vanguardism rests on very specific cognitive, moral, and legal preconditions, and those preconditions would have to be created, or functional alternatives for them would have to be created in the rest of the economy. Then the second problem is the reorganization, the reshaping of the relation of labor to capital. So in the United States today, only 10% of the labor force is unionized. And only 6% of the labor force in the private economy is unionized. So unionization is disappearing, except for governmental employees. And not only is unionization disappearing, but an increasing part of the labor force is being thrown into this precarious situation of temporary, conditional, subcontracted labor. That's incompatible with the establishment of economic vanguardism in a socially inclusive form. You have to have a different kind of law that protects, represents, and organizes precarious labor. Then the third project has to do with the relation of finance to the real economy. By what sets of initiatives can finance be made a good servant rather than a bad master, and enlisted in the service of the productive agenda of society? Now, if you ask me what part of these kinds of initiatives are more accessible in the United States today, where would you begin? It seems to me that one obvious place to begin is what goes under the label of industrial policy in the United States. Every governor in the United States, including all the Republican governors, are trying to have an industrial policy and to have their little Silicon Valley. And they don't know how to do it. So this is a theme that doesn't have to be invented and is not a prerogative of the left. It's a general theme for the renovation of the United States. It's just that the way of addressing it is too primitive, is too limited. Now comes a second large set of initiatives that have to do with education, with the equipping of the individual. So you could say, for the future, not for now, at a different historical moment. The reinvention of the idea of property-owning democracy in a new form, not wedded just to isolated traditional family property. Everyone has a minimum income. Everyone has a basic stake of resources, a social inheritance. But the first task is education, in its content and in its institutional setting. In its content, a form of education for everyone that is analytical, cooperative, and dialectical. And a series of procedures designed to reconcile national standards of investment and quality in education with the local management of the schools by the states and towns. And where do you begin? The natural place to begin in the United States is the debate about national standards and their implementation. Now comes the third large area of the reorganization of democratic politics. So there are three domains for experimentation. One has to do with popular engagement in political life, the financing of political activity, and the access of political parties and social movements to the means of mass communication. The second has to do with the constitutional arrangements of the country, the deliberate slowing down of politics, the association of the liberal principle of fragmentation of power with the conservative principle of the deacceleration of politics through checks and balances, which could be corrected progressively through early elections or through comprehensive programmatic plebiscites or by any number of constitutional innovations. And the third sphere is then the reinvention of federalism. So the doctrine of American federalism, the official doctrine, is experimentalist. The states are described as laboratories of experimentation. But the institutional framework of American federalism is anti-experimentalist because it inhibits collaborative experimentalism among the three levels of the federation or horizontally among the states and among the municipalities. And again, if you ask me, where is the most natural place to begin in the United States in this area of the institutional reshaping of democratic politics, I would say it's in the revivifying and reshaping of American federalism as this vast area of experimentation. That's the place that is most natural, that's least offensive, and that's most accessible to people with many different political positions in the United States. But I'm just making a circumstantial judgment, and I'm an outsider. So you would be able to say much better than me. But what I'm trying to illustrate that by this argument is that once you have the idea of a direction and you begin to give it institutional content, there are always places to begin with the material at hand. But you can't begin if you don't have the conception of a direction. So in this view of the alternative, to my mind, there are three crucial elements. So the first element is a determination to solve the initial problem. The initial problem is the absence of a project that addresses the interests, needs, and aspirations of the working class majority of the country. That problem has to be addressed head on. Otherwise, there's no progressive project. The second component is the insistence on institutional reconstruction. Institutional reconstruction of the market order, not just regulation of the market order, or not just redistributive compensation. And therefore, a project for the supply side of the economy. And the third component is the breaking of the silence of the prophetic voice in the United States, the idea of the greatness of the ordinary man and woman, given new form and new expression, and translated into the debate in popular culture. That's the project. It has to be seen both in detail and in its general form. So none of this is possible without ideas, right? So ideas are the crucial element, and that if there's a central claim in this view, it's that the imagination